Hello, everybody. Scott Golden here with the AEW, I'm sorry, the SmackDown report for the 20th of August, 2021. There's actually good stuff on this show. Most of it's promo segments from legendary people. There's also matches that are just there to fill time, and I don't understand that with the second biggest show of the year being SummerSlam happening in the nature of things. Promo-wise, the show was decent. Match-wise, the show was skippable. And knowing that CM Punk is going to be part of, or assuming that CM Punk is going to be part of this, and with it being SummerSlam go-home weekend, I don't understand the lackadaisical nature of WWE at this point. Anyway, so we move to Edge opening the show. Edge's promo, big surprise, one of the better parts of the program in general. Edge was announced as appearing before the show even began. Edge makes his way to the ring and gets a good pop to start SmackDown. He enters the ring and immediately shows a video package hyping Edge versus Rollins. Edge sits in a chair in the middle of the ring and fans break into Edge chants. Not a big surprise there. Edge heard Rollins' comments last week. He remembers Roman pulling his boot to the back of his neck in 2014. Edge is worried about his future, his wife, and his kids at that point. Edge notes that Rollins threatened all the same things last week and said that he's dangerous. Rollins is a great talent, but he's pushed into a dark place, and fans erupt into cheers as Edge basically says he's going to be more aggressive than ever before. Edge admitted that Rollins pushed him into a place so dark he doesn't know if he can come back from it. Rollins helped Edge find the place in his heart where his blood runs black. Edge does see clearly on this day, and Edge knows that he doesn't have to just beat Rollins. He has to break him, humble him, and burn him down. And ultimately, that's pretty amazing. Ray and Dominic are in the back post this promo. Dominic's sure that Ray will beat Jey Uso tonight, and they're going to win the titles. Ray told him to focus on tonight's match. Dominic pointed out that he won last week and that Ray admitted that it's been tough on Dominic. He pleads with him to focus and watch his back tonight. And Jey Uso with Jimmy Uso defeats Rey Mysterio with Dominic Mysterio 11:26. You can obviously see the father versus son program coming, maybe by the time Survivor Series gets here. Ray and Jey have a decent enough match. Story of the match is Dominic's not listening to his father. He tries to cheat, but backfires, costing Ray the win. Jey has an early advantage. Ray hits Rana to take him over, follows up with the punches in the corner goofiness, and then Jey fights back, catches Ray with a right hand, slows the pace down, and hits the side headlock. Fans break into "Let's go Ray, let's go Jey." And back from the break, Jey is firmly in control with chinlock of doom. Ray fights back with elbows and step up into Guri. Jey recovers and hits a pop up Samoan drop for a near fall. Jey then climbs to the top rope and lifts Ray into position on his shoulders. Ray fights back and hits a Rana off the top rope and a close near fall. Ray then hits a springboard crossbody off the second rope and another near fall. Jey avoids Ray and hits a neckbreaker for a close near fall. And Ray recovers and hits a senton off the rope and gets another close near fall there. Ray then goes to 619, but Jey avoids it and hits the move. Ray then catches Jey in a sunset flip, but Dominic tries to cheat to help his father win. Referee catches him, and Ray spokes to him at ringside. The Usos take advantage and jumps Mysterio. Jey then hits a splash off the top rope to get the win. I mean, you can see the break coming, and that could be fun. They recap Owens beating Corbin last week, and Corbin stealing Big E's Money in the Bank briefcase. Corbin then defeats Kevin Owens by DQ 306. They got virtually no time, and honestly, Corbin doesn't belong on national television. Corbin comes out with Big E's briefcase. Michael Cole and Pat McCaffrey discuss the fact that it doesn't belong to him. Owens jumps Corbin to start the match. Corbin fights back and hits the the spinning clothesline he normally does for near fall. Corbin is in control. Owens nails him with a super kick, and the fans are chanting, "You're still broke," at him. Corbin hangs over Owens over the ropes and goes for a choke slam. Owens avoids it and goes for the stunner. Corbin slips off the back. Big E's music hit. He runs down to ringside. Corbin tries to get to the briefcase first, but Big E knocks him down for the disqualification. Big E then gets the briefcase back, but Corbin attacks him from behind and runs out with the briefcase in through the crowd. In the back, Caleb Braxton interviews women's champion Bianca Belair. They showed a video package recapping Sasha Banks attacking her last week. Braxton noted Belair had her chance at revenge against Banks tomorrow night. Belair doesn't even want to hear Banks' name. She hopes Banks is watching tonight because she's going to take it out on Zelina Vega and Carmella. Belair faces Vega and Carmella in separate matches later. Why? Why, when you have nearly 200 people on the roster, do you have the overexposure of Bianca Belair? This is the first really stupid thing of the program. They announced that Logan Paul is John Morrison's guest on Moist TV on Raw this coming Monday. I don't know that Logan Paul is the ideal individual that you want the Raw audience to tune in for. I don't know that they would either. Championship contenders match Tegan Knox and Shotzi Blackheart defeated the tag team champions Tamina and Natalya. This match is just completely flat. It's fine. Under 3 minutes, I can't really do anything with it. They recap Knox and Shotzi beating the champions a few weeks ago. Colin McCaffrey speculated Knox and Shotzi could get title shot if they win tonight. And they also are happy that Natalya has returned from surgery quickly. Tamina jumps Knox and sends her to the floor. Champions isolate Shotzi, cut her off from the corner. Natalya hits a snap suplex for a near fall, slows down the pace, and goes to a chin lock. Shotzi fights back against Natalya, knocks its crossbody off the apron, and Shotzi then rolls Natalya up for the win. No one cared about this. It's so flat. Anyway, Seth Rollins segment's up next. Fans are into the segment, and they pop for the brood bloodbath, but they never acknowledge the word brood. Anyway, Rollins comes out with a white suit responding to Edge. Fans break into "We want Edge" chants. Rollins then notes that Edge is now, he got him, and the fans erupt into boos. Rollins mocks Edge and claims that he's made a bunch of excuses before. Fans break into loud Edge chants, and Rollins becomes upset and yells at the fans to listen to him. Fans break into "You suck" chants, and Rollins claims that Edge isn't on his level. Brood music starts to play, lights turn red. Edge appears on the big screen and told Rollins that freaks come out in the night. He laughs and said Rollins would never see it coming. Dark liquid of blood dropped on Rollins and shiny white suit from the ceiling. Edge gives him a bloodbath, which the Brood used to do. Anyway, I mean, this was okay, but it's sports entertaining-y, and it's a reference the average fan won't remember. Anyway, Otis with Chad Gable defeats Montez Ford with Angelo Dawkins. No one cared about this, and it's just there to fill time. Short match, Otis dominates Ford for the majority of the match. Ford tries to knock Otis off with a series of clotheslines. Otis doesn't go down. Nails Ford with some back elbows, knocks Ford to the floor. Ford fights back in Zaguri and hits a flying crossbody for near fall. Gable tries to interfere, but Dawkins knocks him off the ring, recovers, and Ford is back to the mat, and then hits the Vader bomb for the win. Literally, who cares about this and why? Like, I don't know who your target is for this stuff. Anyway, so King Nakamura and Rick Boggs defeats Apollo Crews and Commander Aziz. 3 minutes. They didn't get virtually any time. What's the point of having these short matches? None of the talent gets over with these. Anyway, Boggs takes Crews to the mat and plays with his legs like a guitar. Boggs then shows his strength and lifts Crews. Crews fights back. Boggs then tries around the ring Nakamura and Aziz. Do a double tag. Nakamura catches Aziz with a dropkick, but Aziz doesn't go down. Nakamura goes for the Kinshasa, but Aziz counters with a side slam. Boggs and Cruz tag back in, and Nakamura catches Aziz with a sliding dropkick. Finish comes in with Boggs slamming Cruz for the win. Non-title match. Women's champion Bianca Belair defeats Zelina Vega in 2:16. Was it really worth coming back for this? Fans are obviously behind Belair. She's probably one of the bigger stars they've had in the last little while. It seems that they book women better than men these days, except maybe the championship program on either show. Anyway, Vega and Carmella argue about who should face Belair first. Carmella teases getting in the ring, but throws Vega in instead. Belair has the early advantage. Fans break into the EST chant. Carmella causes distraction. Vega used a sunset flip for close near fall. Fans break into another chant. Vega attempts a Rana, but Belair catches her with a powerbomb. Belair drops Vega on the turnbuckle and hits the KOD for the win. Post-match, Carmella jumps Belair with a series of super kicks, and then they go at it for 4 minutes here. Back from the break, Carmella jumps Belair at the bell, backs Belair into the corner, and then hits a series of back elbows, follows up with a Bronco Buster for near fall. Carmella slows the pace down and gets chin lock. Belair stands up with Carmella on her back and turns Carmella around into a vertical suplex. Belair avoids a super kick and hits a handspring backflip over the near fall. Carmella recovers and catches Belair in the ring with the apron skirt, follows up with a super kick for near fall, and Belair hits spine buster and KOD for the pin. Cena and Roman with a face-to-face to close the program. This is a good go-home for the Rumble. Reigns and Paul Heyman make their entrance. There is a Cena chant, and they also do Let's Go Roman, Let's Go Cena, so the crowd's pretty split, which you'd expect, because there are no baby faces and heels in national wrestling anymore, at the main event level anyway. Reigns starts to speak. Fans erupt into boos for Reigns. Reigns claims that Cena lied and said some stupid things last week. He's upset that Cena thinks he can pin him 1-2-3. Reigns asks Heyman when was the last time he lost. Heyman points out that this version of Reigns is undefeated. Cena's happy that the fans believe anything can happen. Cena notes a month ago everyone believed Roman would beat him at SummerSlam because he'd go to shoot a movie. Cena notes the movie part is true, but Reigns isn't keeping the title. Cena promised to win the title and leave to shoot the movie. Cena said he'd take one distraction for Cena to win 1-2-3. Fans chant along and Cena counts. Cena promises to win the title and wouldn't be back until WrestleMania in Dallas. Reigns mocks Cena. He notes that he beaten past challengers so badly WWE doesn't have time to use them anymore. Reigns claims he could go to Hollywood and be in the movies if he wanted. Reigns pointed out that they're in Vegas tomorrow, so he would raise the stakes. He promised to win tomorrow night or he leaves WWE. They shake hands, but Reigns tries to attack him. Cena recovers and rolls up Reigns for a Phantom 3 count to prove that he could beat him. Cena celebrates on the ramp, and they end SmackDown on that. I mean, the whole if I don't win, I leave thing kind of kills the angle, but it is what it is. Anyway, we'll be back with more right after this.